and welcome back to my reflection of the 13th Doctor, Jodie Whittaker, Chris Chibnall eras of Doctor Who. This is part two of a 5, 6, 7 part video series. Yeah, I think it's going to be 6 or 7, depending if I do Doctor Who Redacted or not, but numbered 0 to 6 because the introduction was part 0. So, yeah, previously in part 1, we touched upon series 11, or season 37, and the 2019 New Year special, Resolution. In the previous video, part 0, we did the introduction and took a look at the 2017 Christmas special, Twice Upon a Time, which featured the first scene of the 13th Doctor. Today, we will be taking a look at the most controversial series of Doctor Who ever made, arguably. Series 12, or Season 38, which is the second series, and stuff's just falling down, of the 13th Doctor era, plus the 2021 New Year special, Revolution of the Daleks. Before I start, I will say that the 2020 New Year special, Spyfall Part 1, is not a special. It is Episode 1 of the series. Are we clear? Good. Thank you. So, Series 12. To be honest, this is mainly just the most controversial series, mainly due to, like, 2 episodes, to be honest. But it gained such a negative reputation overall. Okay, it's about maybe 3 episodes if you go with that take. But controversial mainly for 2, but not negative reception, mainly for 3. But yeah, this is one of the most controversial and negatively received series of the show by the fan base. Not just the Not My Doctors, the fan base and people just watching. Even the people who didn't watch it had some things to say about it, just from some secondhand sources. So, yeah, and I know that firsthand because I received some comments about that. You know who you are. I mean, some people may say some series are worse or more controversial. I know Series 9 was quite unpopular at the time, and of course the other two of these series are quite unpopular. Several classic series, Season 24 especially, but I suppose if you were going to boil it down to the one the fan base considers the most controversial and or the weakest, this probably fits the former and is a good contender for the latter in the eyes of the fan base. So let's have a look at these episodes. What makes Series 12 so controversial? So we start off with the first 2 episodes of the series, Spyfall Parts 1 and 2. And for the second time in the new series' life, we've got a story, which is just one title, but for 2 episodes, we've got the part 1, part 2 thing from the classic series back. Hooray! This is the second time after The End of Time, which broadcast on Christmas Day 2009 and New Year's Day 2010. So we technically ended the 2000s and started the 2010s on a part 1, part 2 single story title story. And we're starting the 2020s with that, with Spyfall. I know some people have criticised the title for being a bit boring and just the James Bond film Skyfall, but changed the K for a P and it's Spyfall. But honestly, I like it. And honestly, after Goldfinger and The Spy Who Loved Me, it's a bit trickier to have parody Bond film titles in there. Some of them work pretty well, but I certainly some of the Connery and Moore ones. But once you get later on to like Brosnan, Dalton, and Craig, is a bit more difficult. And I think, yeah, this one actually kind of fits. It also works well in the context of the story, as spies from across the world are being assassinated by, as it turns out to be, alien spies from another dimension. Oh, that means we can now all parody that scene from Twin Dilemma. And we all know the fate of alien spies. Please don't strangle anybody. Anyway, sorry, I just enjoyed doing that. But yeah, so these alien spies from another dimension are coming to kill people so they can take over Earth or something. And they've teamed up with this guy called Daniel Barton, played by Lenny Henry. He's doing this because, I don't know, I don't know why he's doing this. He's just doing this. Yeah, he's kind of like another one of those, I guess, kind of like a Steve Jobs or Elon Musk or Mark Zuckerberg play a type of character. He's a tech giant, social media guy or something, whatever. Yeah, and he's quite rich and stuff, and all that type of stuff. Henry does a great job in the role. I don't think the character's that much, but he's pretty creepy when Lenny Henry leans into that side of the performance. But yeah, pretty fun character there. Really enjoyed him. Also, his one of his people who works for him is a big fan of Patrick Troughton's Doctor. Watch the episode if you want to know what I mean. But it turns out Daniel Barton, I almost forgot the character's name there because it's Lenny Henry. Daniel Barton may not be the main villain behind this. So Stephen Fry's C, not to be confused with C played by Andrew Scott in the James Bond film Spectre, sends the Doctor and her gang to try and stop Barton and the aliens. But like I said, Barton may not be the one behind all of this. Well, he's partly behind it, but he's not the main bad guy. There's a spy master behind all of this, and Barton's just one piece of the cog that this spy master has devised. So the Doctor and her friends go and speak to this other spy master, played by Sacha Dhawan, to help them try and figure it out. And ultimately, we discover that his spy master has actually replaced the Doctor's friend and has taken his identity and is also the spy master behind the Kazavian, these alien creatures that are coming from this other dimension. And he's also behind Daniel Barton, and he's also the spy master. Now, he's the master of spies. I mean, he is the master, and in this incarnation, he's known as the spy master. That's right, the master's back! Woo! Even though we last saw them in The Doctor Falls, so technically this is... we just had a series without him, / her, and now they're back. But my god, what a reveal! Yeah, maybe there could have been a bit more hints there, or maybe we could have gotten some more time to get to know O, like we did with Professor Yana back in Utopia. But my god, what a reveal! That was brilliant! Apart from maybe having a bit more hints, but you know... It was a great reveal. Sacha Dhawan, as soon as he changes, he's going for it. He's amazing. I mean, he was great as O, but now he's the master. He's all fun and games. And it's really fun to watch. Dhawan's performance of the master, I think, reaches its peak in the next episode. And I'm really looking forward to seeing how it is in the upcoming centenary special. But wow, that was such a great moment. That was so good. One of the best moments of the year. It's just brilliant. Also, Second Akinola's score for the Master is also brilliant. He had a pretty good score in Series 11, but I think he ups his game for Series 12, even if he says, oh, you don't really change that much in the music score, I don't agree with, but at least he does kind of do something a little bit different here with his Master and Spy themes, especially the rendition of the track Me and My Friends, or Me and My Mates, I should say, given a bit of a James Bond theme jazz up. It's really great. But his Master theme is absolutely phenomenal. My favourite track of his, I think, is either that or the Cyberman theme coming up later this series. But wow, just what a great scene. Part one of this story is a pretty good episode with the characters just trying to figure out this mystery. There's a bit of a sci-fi element. It would have been nice to have more of the James Bond pastiche elements in there, as opposed to C giving them the gadgets and them rocking up in tuxedos to the party. But yeah, we're gonna have a few more moments of pastiche stuff, or even just spy stuff. But it works as an effective first episode. Again, just like Woman Who Fell to Earth. I don't think I put this episode above that, but it's definitely a pretty effective episode. Part two introduces time travel to the mix, as well as give Sacha Dhawan free range as the master. He mixes some of that classic feel master with John Sim and Michelle Gomez's insanity, and it works really brilliantly. He has a bit of a sadness as well, as we discover later, as he's the one who destroys Gallifrey again. More on that later, because that's a big talking point. I think this is his character at his best. It's really great. Barton, though, of course, does play more second fiddle in this story, and ultimately he ends up not being that great, but he does get away with what he's done somehow. I thought he might be brought back later on, but unless it's going to be in the centenary special, I don't think so. So one of the criticisms of Chibnall's villains is that they do get away sometimes. In some cases, yes, but not all the case. I don't think the Morricks got away with what they did. Charlie didn't get away, he died. The Patin, I guess you could say, got away, but at the same time, it was forcibly ejected. And those spiders are probably going to die in that vault. So, yeah. And I thought Crasco had died, but maybe he hadn't. But yeah, I can understand what some people are saying. But yeah, Barton gets away. The Master, on the other hand, he's defeated. But yeah, there's some good stuff in here. But I think this is gonna start the trend of having the companions all having to do something, even if they don't have to. And the Doctor's more interested in talking to supporting characters like Ada Gordon, future Ada Lovelace, and Noor India Khan. I think I botched that. Sorry. She's more interested in playing around with these historical figures than she is with her own companions. And the script is trying to give them something to do. It even riffs off Last of the Time Lords a bit. Well, Sound of Drums, actually. With them having to hide out in a abandoned building yard after becoming Britain's Most Wanted. And it's got the Master in it. Oh boy. Oh yeah, that's another trend that's going to start coming up around here. Just rifting on some of the RTD and sometimes Moffat era stories for these. And whilst I don't mind doing that for inspiration, please don't copy and paste. Christ, I think maybe this was the whole beginning of the build-up to RTD's return. Have Series 12 feel a bit more RTD in some elements, and ultimately the grand climax is the return of RTD as showrunner. Maybe this was the BBC's plan all along. Maybe Chibnall was just a pawn in their game to get RTD back, and he was just used as the bridge between the end of Moffat and the return of RTD. Call me conspiracy nuts, but it's not this feasible. Overall, I think Spyfall Part 2 is a solid episode, but I think Part 1 is stronger in telling the story it wants to tell, and it's a bit more interesting and a bit more enjoyable. But, of course, Part 2 is made mostly by the Master. It's absolutely fun. Also, putting the Doctor in tougher positions without her family nearby, and just trying to sort out her old enemy once again. Now, the ending of the episode sees the revelation of the Master having destroyed Gallifrey due to discovering some secrets that the Time Lords had been keeping from them about the Timeless Child, which is first mentioned in the Ghost Monument, but only touched upon there and never again until now. But now it's going to become a major arc of the 13th Doctor's era. Apparently Chibnall did think about having an arc for Series 11, but decided not to worry about that and just have the character development as the arc. Mainly because Series 11 was supposed to bring in a new audience. But the problem is, this is a 3-series long arc, and the third series got cut short due to fucking COVID. So, not the best move. I mean, you can predict COVID. Who could predict COVID? Apart from who, but apart from them, who could have predicted COVID? But if you've only got 3 series, it would be better to maybe kickstart that up maybe halfway through. So, yeah, or maybe have more episodes, or both. But, yeah. Anyway, the Timeless Child's back. We're going to find out more about it later on. But, yeah, so apparently the truth about it. It's why the Master destroyed Gallifrey. This is the second time Gallifrey's been destroyed. And at the time, following Hellbent, this could be seen as the... Well, there wasn't really much else Chibnall could do with Gallifrey after that, apart from ignore it. Because Hellbent kind of screwed up the Doctor-Time Lord relationship so much in that story. I mean, Moffat brought Gallifrey back just to throw it away again. Not destroy it, but he kind of just... He brought it back. And then he did nothing with it, besides the shit in Hellbent. So, yeah, I don't blame Chibnall for just getting rid of it. Because he doesn't have to deal with it. And also, this means RTD doesn't have to deal with it either. Unless something happens in the Centenary. So, he gets to have his cake and eat it a second time. Oh boy. But it is getting tiring of Gallifrey just coming and going, coming and going, because I'm sure it would be brought back at some point later down the line. Maybe not by RTD. I know if I was showrunner, I would. Yeah, I would go there. Though I would definitely utilise it more after bringing it back, more than Moffat did. So, at least on time to time, at the very least. Anyway, so I've babbled long enough about Spyfall. But suffice to say, this is just the start of this controversial arc. Well, it's going to be more controversial when we get to the end, basically. So hold on tight. But before we get to that, let's have the worst episode of the series. Now, I know that many people would say the finale. I suppose objectively, maybe. But subjectively, it's this one. Orphan fucking 55, written by Ed Heim. Oh, and the last two were written by Chris Chibnall, of course. Orphan 55. My God, what a terrible episode. It's... Okay, you know what I was saying about how Chibnall feels to me that the companions need to do stuff all the time in every episode and not just have, like, say, sit on the sidelines for something and it just has more stuff added to the episode. Well, how about we do that for the entire supporting cast? Now, I suppose if you only had, like, two or three supporting characters, it was, like, seven total, it's not so bad. There's about 11 or 12 characters, including the four mains, in this episode, not including background characters and the dregs, the monsters of the week. Okay, who we got? We've got fucking Bella, we got fucking Kane, we got fucking Wilma, we got fucking Benny, we got Revy, I think his name is, we got his son, we got this other dude, and we got this cat lady. I think that's it. Plus some characters in the background, but nobody cares about them. Too many supporting characters. Too many. I mean, one probably would be so bad if it was like, say, it's like Bella, Kane, couple of others, two or three others. Maybe one to die, one to make it out alive, and one could go either way. Maybe gets out alive because Bella and Kane are going to die, but... unless you want a really big body count, but yeah, this one just has too many supporting characters and it just ends up being a bit of a mess. The plot also initially starts like a nice holiday relaxing place that's going to be invaded by these aliens before becoming a political message midway through. And to be honest, this could work if handled right, but the plot just kind of stops to be political, and the end is just the Doctor turning to a camera and making a big speech about climate change and global warming. And I think this message could have been displayed so much better through storytelling and through delivering the message naturally than just turning to the audience and preaching. This is why Jodie Whittaker's Doctor has gotten the reputation of being the preachy Doctor. I'm not saying we shouldn't do anything about climate change. I'm not saying we shouldn't spread the message. I'm saying the message was handled badly in this episode. And it just drags the story down. Oh, and Wilma going, Benny! Gets annoying after a while. It's funny to start with, but after a while, it gets annoying. I think someone did a count of it. It's like 19 to 23 times she says that in the episode. Not including saying his name normally, I don't think. So, yeah. Some good actors in here, but not utilized very well. At least it looks nice in places, especially at Tranquility Spa. But, yeah. Bad story. This is my least favourite episode of the Whittaker era so far. Let's get something a bit better. Nikola Tesla's Night of Terror, written by... Is it Nina Mandur? Have I said that? Well, they don't list their writers on here anymore. I think it's Nina Mandur. She's either the writer or the director. Now, this one's much better. When I first saw this one, I thought it was good, but not great. So, again, that one just got a good review. But on reflection, rewatching it last year and giving it the new review, it was brilliant. I think this is now my second favourite of the series, after another historical set story coming up later down the line. Nikola Tesla's Night of Terror again takes a look at a historical figure, just like Rosa Parks, and also the challenges that that guy had to go through in part of his life. It is a bit of a shame that most of the stuff about these people is just like Wikipedia entries and stuff, the start of them. But it's interesting to learn about these characters as we go through the story as well, the struggles and how they react as a character in the story. And unlike last series' stories, where any one, two, or even all three could have been pure historicals and didn't need the aliens, this one kind of works with the aliens, even more so than the Vajarians watching people when they die, or Krasko coming from the future. This one works pretty nicely with these scorpion creatures who can't make anything for themselves. They're too fucking lazy or unable to do it, so they have to steal it from other creatures, and they're trying to get Tesla to do something for them. And Angie Mahindra, who played Rani Chandra in the Sarah Jane Adventures, is back to chew the scenery as the Skiffwick Queen, as she's known in this episode. Also, fun fact, Angie Mahindra was, and might still be, Sacha Dhawan's partner. So he gets a nice little credit at the end of that Sarah Jane Adventures Minnesota thing that came out in April 2020. Oh, that's nice. They're both in the same series. Different episodes, but same series. But yeah, Mahindra is brilliant in that role. Even if the Skiffer don't really do anything, but hey, I suppose that's in character for them. Most of the scenes outside of those are stolen by Nikola Tesla, played by, I can't remember his name, like Gorovit, Gorov something. But he's brilliant. And we also got Thomas Edison in a less friendly portrayal of his character. It's a more of a negative portrayal of Thomas Edison, but without making him a full-on villain. He does team up with Tesla and the crew to fight the Skiffer, even if they're back to being rivals afterwards. And we've also got, is it Miss Skerritt? She's really nice as well, as Tesla's own companion, let's say, his assistant. And they've got a nice development. You know what I was thinking about, having how the last episode had too many supporting characters, and they kind of crammed them in with the main cast? This episode has a nice number of supporting characters. Just three main supporting characters who help the Doctor and team, a couple of others here and there that don't really do a huge amount, and are villains. So, yeah, nice, simple, good. And this is where Yaz starts coming to her own as a character. At the time, I didn't think so, but on reflection, this is starting to get Yaz more to do outside of the group and giving her a bit more of a personality here and there. So, yeah, Nikola Tesla's Night of Terror, an underrated gem. And this is the first historical that isn't too difficult to watch due to the subject matter. So, after this, I suppose it's time for another fun, rolloping sci-fi adventure. Just like the last three times, right? Well, next is Fugitive of the Jadoon, which, on the surface, appears that way. But holy shit, is this episode going to take a complete U-turn in its story. So the plot of this one sees the Jadoon breaking law to come to Earth, in Gloucester to be precise, and try and find this fugitive that's apparently evading them, and they try to capture slash kill this fugitive. Typical Jadoon stuff, maybe coming to, breaking law instead, their laws, instead of taking the location to the moon or something. But, you know, other than that, typical Jadoon stuff, like we've seen in Smith and Jones, Sarah Jane Adventures, Prison of the Jadoon, and some of their other stuff in expanded media. I recently listened to a Big Finish audio called Jadoon in Chains, so that's definitely another example of that. So, you know what, typical Jadoon stuff we've seen or heard or read before. To begin with, and the Doctor and Company swoop in to try and see if they can keep the peace. But then something happens. Graham disappears and is transported elsewhere, with Yaz and Ryan following suit, leaving the Doctor to find out who this fugitive is on her own. We think it's this guy called Lee, but it turns out to be his wife, Ruth, played by Jo Martin. And why does that name ring a bell? Who is this fugitive? Well, we know it's Jo Martin's character, Ruth, but who is it really? Because it can't, Ruth is just a name hiding their identity. Who is it really? And who is chasing them? This is a woman called Gat or something? Who's she working for? Well, strap in, folks. We're going to have the mother of all reveals. But before we do that, we're going to have the father of all reveals. As it turns out, Grain, Ryan and Yaz are transported to a ship in the far future that Captain Jack Harkness has hijacked and is doing stuff. And basically, he's basically there to show up. So he's going to be coming back in a later episode, which is going to be the New Year special. And basically takes the companions out of the episode. Yep. If the story can't find something for the companions to do, it's going to write them out. Maybe give them something to do whilst it's writing out. But yeah. So at the time, this was amazing. Captain Jack was back. And then he didn't really do that much. The buzz was mainly about him being back, but on reflection, he didn't do that much in this episode, apart from spouting some stuff predicting both his return in the New Year special and the Lone Sideman in the last three episodes of the series. And that was it. Yay. Thankfully, he is better utilised in the New Year special, but again, it's basically here for fan service and setup. Right, okay. But that's not even the biggest ball curve in this episode. The biggest ball curve is the reveal of Ruth being another secret incarnation of the Doctor. Oh boy. Again, this was mind-blowing back at the time, and it inspired all the fan theories. But I think, judging by what we're going with, I can't say for the Centennial Special just yet, we'll have to wait until it airs, but I think from what we're looking at, it is definitely pre-Hartnell. More about that later, but pre-Hartnell Doctors, and timeline doesn't seem to match up. We're going to have to fan theory our way around it, because Chibnall's going to keep it pretty secretive. I know he was going to have her be an Indian princess initially, on the run from the Jadoon for something. Maybe it's like Delta and the Bannerman situation, where these evil race of creatures are trying to kill them or something. And then he changes it to the Doctor, and a secret Doctor from before the first Doctor, and has the Time Lords, and yada, 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 yada. You know the rest. You know about this reveal. You know about this story. You know about this arc. You know the rest. Now, like I said, I can't speak for Centennial Special or post-Centennial Special, but for pre-Centennial Special, this hasn't really gone down well. More on this later, but yeah. Oh boy, is this. This is a massive U-turn. Oh boy. And a massive continuity fuck-up. Oh, but you thought this was just, that was it. Ooh. No, we're just halfway through the ride. What makes it even worse is Jim Martin's a fantastic Doctor. Even if a character's mainly there just to grind her teeth at 13. But Martin does such a charismatic and convicted performance in the role, that it'd be nice to see more of her. And we're going to get some comics and audios. So we will see and hear. Not so much on television, though. Maybe she'll be in the Centenary. But yeah. It feels like it's just an addition for the sake of it, though. As great of a Doctor she is, outside just gritting her teeth at 13, it would be nice to know more of her. At least we got to know a bit more about John Hurt's War Doctor in the one episode he appeared in, before Expander Media took the rest of their baggage. Whilst Joe Martin's Doctor is so shrouded in mystery that even if they did do Expander Media on the story, that's not really going to answer the questions. Unlike the War Doctor, who got most of our questions were answered for in his first, arguably second episode, arguably third. But the first one or two were basically just teasers and then got the main meat. Basically starters and then your main course. With this Doctor, all we've gotten is starters and Expander Media stuff, which I suppose you could say is either sides or dessert. But where's the main course? And I'm not expecting the Centenary Special to do it. The closest we got is episode 3 of series 13, Once Upon Time, but still, doesn't really help. So I think that's what's the main problem with this reveal, is the fact that we don't really do anything with it once it's happened. Again, the Centini special could throw this in a complete new curveball U-turn. But from Chibnall's discussions about it in an interview a few months ago, unless he is holding out on us, unless he's making us wait for a surprise, I'm not expecting it. So if it does, then that'll be a great surprise. But in the meantime, yeah, oh well, I guess we'll just have to let Titan Comics and Big Finish Productions sort it out. It's what they're best at. Especially Big Finish. In fact, I trust them more than Titan, because Titan, they can be even more loose and fast with the continuity than the TV series. And so can Big Finish, but, you know, I trust them more. On to Praxeas. Now, this one's another environmental message, one that isn't subtle. It's very in the face, but I think the story handles it better than Orphan 55 did. Pete Mattie returns to write this one. Oh yeah, the last one was written by Vinay Patel and Chris Chibnall. And I think Praxeas does a better job with the environmentalist message than Orphan 55, as I said. Maybe not as much as Arachnids in the UK, believe it or not. But it does handle the plastics and microplastics in the ocean being pretty situation well. And interesting, including a kind of a space virus affecting people and birds. So we get some stuff. So we get a bit of a modern version of the birds, or a more a higher budget version of Birdemic incorporated into Doctor Who. And it works pretty well with the story. It's pretty fun in places. The story's not that great, but it could have been better. But I do like what it does. It's also interesting splitting up the TARDIS team, with the Doctor going to Madagascar, Ryan to Brazil, and Graham and Yaz to Hong Kong, where they team up with Jake, one of the supporting characters in the story. And again, small supporting cast, great stuff with them for the most part. Also, Jake's played by Warren Brown, who's amazing. Also, I should mention one of the other supporting characters, one of the Madagascan crew, is played by an actor who sadly was killed, I think, a day before his 25th birthday, this time last year, or last November. It was, yeah, about October, November last year, and we didn't really know about it until a few months ago. So, this video is in tribute to him. He's the guy who played, I can't remember his name, but he's the guy who, the black guy in South Africa who's on the beach and gets killed by the birds and nobody notices. He's helping Suki, who he doesn't know it, but she's the main villain of the story. He doesn't know that. He just thinks she's another scientist or something. But yeah, he's that guy. That's South African guy in the Madagascar scenes. And sadly, the actor was killed about a year ago. Ish. So, yeah, I hope he's resting in peace up in heaven. And this video is dedicated to him. Something a bit more upbeat. The Brazilian side character is fun most of the time. And Suki isn't, well, she's played well by the actress, and the character could be given a bit of a motivation. I know some people would be disappointed that neither the Sea Devils nor the Autons were responsible for any of this, but I think the idea of having this alien race mess around with Earth like a petri dish, experimenting on them, whether that's viruses or otherwise, is pretty interesting. Also, if this episode had aired any later than, this aired at the start of February 2020, if this aired later on in the year, this episode would certainly have been pulled due to the coronavirus pandemic. It's actually quite scary how similar they are, minus the fact that this virus is exaggerated to be worse. But yeah, if this episode had aired later in the year, it would have been pulled. Mainly because of the connections and ties with the coronavirus pandemic. Of course, it was written and made even before the pandemic was even discovered, let alone airing around the time it was starting to spread across the world. And eventually, about a month and a half later, it was a big deal. So, yeah. So it's probably a good thing it aired when it did. Oh, I should say, Chris Chibnall also co-wrote this episode with Pete Mattie. And like I said with Kablam, I think this is his weaker of the two stories, but I do think he's better writing those the collection box sets, minisodes slash trailers that are included on them and to promote them. I certainly do recommend checking out the season 22 one with Perry. That also includes a character from Kablam, an actor from Kablam playing a character in that. So I do highly recommend checking that one out. Next up is Can You Hear Me, written by Charlene James and Chris Chibnall. So Chris Chibnall's got quite a few things in pies, but one story, which is the next one, I'll get onto that next time, he doesn't have a co-writer credit on, and he probably should, because he probably had more involvement on that than either of these two. And probably also Rosa. So, anyway, so Can You Hear Me basically is supposed to be about the companions experiencing some bad dreams, not unlike, say, the Nightmare Man from the Sarah Jane Adventures, in the story called The Nightmare Man, or the Dream Lord from Amy's Choice. But he turns out to be a creature from, like, the Dawn of Time, like the called the Immortals, like the Eternals from Enlightenment, the Guardians from that story, Terminus and Mordred Undead from that trilogy of stories, plus the Key to Time season, and also the Toymaker from the Celestial Toymaker. So, yeah, he's an interesting being, an immortal who wants to have fun, and Ian Gelder is really great in the role. This is such an interesting character, and he does such a great job. But the story seems to be more interested in delving into this other random side character from Aleppo in the 1300s than the main characters. And it also introduces another being like Ian Gelder's character, Zelin, and it makes her an even more powerful god, but there she isn't as interesting or charismatic as Zelin. We got more time with him. He was more to know about him, more charming, charismatic. And then we have this other person who's more powerful, but we don't really know them as much. Even though the plot is about Graham getting a message from her to try and help her get out of this prison thing, only to discover she's actually one of the bad guys. Whoopsies. The story also finally taps into some of Yaz's backstory and gives Ryan some bit of motivation to why he wants to leave at the end of his time travelling with the Doctor in the New Year special coming up. More on that later. And also more about Graham's concerns about his cancer. Sadly, the scene at the end where he talks to the Doctor about it, while I can understand why they were going for with the Doctor wouldn't really know what to say, the way that we see it on screen isn't handled really well. I understand the Doctor not being sure what to say about it, but I think they would still try. They'd try to do their best. This is the Doctor, after all. Even this incarnation can do it. And it just doesn't really handle it really well, even if it's trying to be realistic. Yaz's backstory is probably the most interesting part of all of these, as it does show her being almost suicidal a few years prior, before joining the police as a way to, after a deal with a police officer who came to see her, and eventually finding it fun. So she goes to visit that police officer and to give her a 50p as part of the deal. That was in the deal. And it's got some good moments in here. It's quite nice. Some elements of this, like the mental health stuff. This is a mental health focused episode. So this might be tough to watch, like some of the stuff in the historical episodes are probably tough to watch. And I totally get that, I totally understand it. I do think the mental health side was handled better in Vincent and the Doctor, though, with his mental health and how the Crefeus represented an unseen monster that Vincent has to fight. But now it's physical, not just mental. And he has to fight that alone until the Doctor and Amy turn up and help. And after defeating the monster, he's given us a glimmer of hope. I found that episode handled the mental health elements perfectly, or almost perfectly, at least. It was absolutely beautiful. This one, I think, is because it's juggling three main characters and the odd side character, a couple of side characters. Well, actually, it's not so much Ryan, it's his friend. It's juggling the main three, a couple of side characters, or three of the main four, I should say, a couple of side characters, and these powerful villains, and time-hopping, space-hopping. It's a kind of a bit all over the place, but I suppose the central message is still there, and it works. It's just a shame that the episode could have been a bit more smooth all focused with what it wanted to do. Moving on to The Haunting of Villa Diodati, written by Maxine Alderton and properly uncredited Chris Chibnall. And this episode is my favourite story of the series. We got gothic horror. We got a spooky presence, as it's set around the time Mary Shelley wrote Frankenstein and was inspired by it. Now, Big Finish has covered this story with the fourth part of the Company of Friends Mary story, as well as a trilogy of Mary Shelley stories, where she joins the Eighth Doctor on his travels, which includes The Silver Turk, which is a Frankenstein-inspiring story featuring the Cybermen. So what does Chris Chibnall and Maxine Alderton do with this story? They have the Cybermen turn up to inspire Mary Shelley about Frankenstein. Guys, you do realise Big Finish already did this, right? Well, just like how World Enough in Time touched upon the Cybermen's origins, but in a different location, just like Spare Parts did, this story kind of changes time a little bit. Maybe the fact that the Siberian being sent back in time changes things, and the Eighth Doctor never comes to Villa Diodati, or he turns up later on, and the 13th Doctor and co. go and see Mary instead. Maybe that's why they decided to go, because 13 forgot she did, or lost a memory of that happening, or it never happened, so it was erased from time. So she goes and has a visit. A bit like how the fourth Doctor going to Sharda doesn't happen in the context of the sequel series, thanks to the events of the Five Doctors. Or at least that's how I choose to see it. Even though he technically does, but due to time meddling, he ends up not doing so and has to go back in his eighth incarnation to do the story again, but slightly different. So that's kind of what we got here, except this time it's very different. Because this time the Siberian is causing stuff. Percy Shelley, for instance, he's now sort of ghostly figure. He's not a ghost, but he's kind of being a ghostly figure. And the Cyberman, or it's a Cyberman called Ashad, is coming back to collect this Siberian thing. Now, the first half of this episode is brilliant. Scary, spooky, setting up your traditional horror story. It's great. It's got all the tropes and the trappings. Really great, with a bit of a sci-fi element. And then the Cyberman turns up, and holy shit, it's also a really great Cyberman story. Because Ashad, part converted, but still regains some of his humanity in there, but is mostly driven by Cyberman nature, is trying to find this thing so he can convert people into the future after the Cyber Wars, where they are pretty damn strong in the future, but the resistance is fighting strongly back. And yeah, this is a pretty damn great story. This is a really great one, and the characters are great. Small, nice, a condensed cast, but they all get some stuff to do. Pretty damn great, and really enjoyable, absolutely brilliant. This is my favourite story of the series. It's just brilliant. Written great, directed great, performed great, visuals look stunning, the atmosphere is all there, and yeah, absolutely brilliant story. Don't even mind that it travels along the same routes that Big Finish did back in 2009 and 2011, because it handles this new story really well. So yeah, Haunting of Villa Diodati, absolutely brilliant. And that's the end of Series 12. That wasn't so bad. I mean, not every episode was that great. It was, I mean, there was a couple of not so great ones in there, and that whole Fugitive Doctor reveal was a bit odd, but you know, this was an alright series. I don't see what the controversy is. And there's a couple of not so good ones, and Orphan 55, my god. But still, you know, it's mostly alright. You know, I don't get the hatred. A nice 8 episode series. Lovely. Okay, not all of them, but you know, lovely, lovely, lovely. No, that's it. That's the end of the series. There's nothing more. We just got the New Year special. We just got the New Year one. Okay, let's go to the New Year special. Revolution. What are you saying? There's another 2 episodes left. What do you mean? There's another 2 episodes left. What am I missing? What do you mean? The most controversial episode ever, and the one before it. No, there's no more episodes after Haunting of Villa Diodati, apart from the New Year special. I'm going to go on to that one now. I'm going to talk about Revolution of the Daleks. What do you mean I have to talk about Ascension of the Cybermen and the Timeless Children? What do you mean it's part of Series 12? I didn't think those two episodes were canon. I thought people were making those up. Oh, I can't. I'm sorry, audience. I'm messing with you. I was pretending to avoid those two episodes, but there's no avoiding them. The finale. Ascension of the Sidemen and the Time Children. The first episode is a waste of space. Ascension of the Sidemen has a bit of a setup, but half the episode is dedicated to fucking Brendan, who does fuck hell. And there isn't really much really going on. The Doctor comes and some Doctor and friends help some survivors and resistance fight the Sidemen and Ashad. It's a bit of a talk. Some of them go onto a Sideman ship. We get introduced to the new Cyber Warriors. Okay, this is all fine and good. Fair enough. But half the episode is spent setting up this fucking Brendan stuff, who ends up being feck all to the plot. And in the next episode, it's feck all. And the reason why we're seeing these scenes don't make sense. Well, it makes sense to the audience, but apparently the Doctor's also seeing them, and it doesn't appear on screen that way. We don't know that she's seeing these visions until she's told that in the next episode. So what was the point? Okay, but in all honesty, Ascension of the Sidemen is not really the one we're going to talk about. It's just kind of there. Some good stuff to set up, but ultimately it kind of gets swept under the rug for what happens in the next episode. As when the Doctor, Ryan and a survivor meet Kushamas, a guy who can lead them to a port gateway to another world, it turns out it's to Gallifrey, a destroyed Gallifrey, as we saw earlier in the series, and the Master comes through and basically says that the Doctor should be afraid. Now, at the time of the broadcast, I will admit that was also a great cliffhanger. But on reflection, what happens next is some of the worst things in Doctor Who. Okay, I really don't want to go too long about Time's Children because this video is coming to be a bit too long. I've done two long reviews about this story and a reaction. I don't need to talk, unless I was doing a dedicated video about it, I don't need to talk about this much more. Other than, oh boy, this stuff goes all fuckle. Oh, and I've got Revolution of the Daleks to talk about as well. Okay, let's get through this as quick as possible because I don't really want to be here that long. Because this video is turning out to be far too long. I spent too long at Spyfall. Okay. Apparently the Doctor's the Timeless Child. Whoop-dee-doo. And apparently she had incarnations before William Hartnell. Whoop-dee-doo. And the Master presents it as a PowerPoint presentation. Whoop-dee-doo. And there's also stuff with the Sidemen still going on. Whoop-dee-doo. And the companions and the supporting characters need to do stuff. Whoop-dee-doo. And it all just comes down to big fucking mess. Not only is this a massive change of continuity just for the sake of it, and not a very good one either, and, I mean, it could have been worked in, but Chris Chibnall decided not to. And it's basically set up for something that doesn't really get explored that much later down the line. Maybe Series 13 was 10 episodes, but fucking COVID sorted that. So, but even the episodes we did get, only episode 5 of that series kind of teased it and then decided not to bother with it anymore. Maybe the centenary, but that's going to have a heck of a lot of work to do with all of what's lined up for that, plus what we might not even know is in it until we see it. Yeah, that's basically anything we don't know now that turns out to be in the episode, or anything that isn't rumoured or guessed that turns out to be in the episode. Oh! And it's just handled so badly. The changes to continuity, unnecessary, but if you're going to do them, can you at least introduce them in a decent way, or at least make it make sense, or tie it in well? It doesn't work. It's not just the concept that doesn't work, which is probably that's what everybody is getting upset about. Almost everybody, the majority of people are getting upset about the concept. It's not just the concept, guys. There's much worse to it than that, because the concept, yeah, you know, on paper, not so bad, I suppose, if you wanted to tackle it, but in execution, it doesn't work. At least in this episode, it's not handled well. That's the problem. Not the concept, the execution. Although the concept isn't much better, but it could have worked if handled better. Jesus fucking Christ. That's why Lungbarrow's got a... Actually, I don't know if its reputation is positive, but it's got a well-known reputation for trying to do what it does. It's not too dissimilar, but... Well, it's different, but not too dissimilar. But at least it's a whole book to do that. This is just 65 minutes. And you got a whole other plot on top of that. Two, maybe even three. This episode is just a fucking mess. Maybe if Ascension of the Cybermen had a bit more Cyberman stuff, or a bit more Gallifrey stuff, not just fucking Brendan, then maybe it could have been dealt with well over two episodes. But one of them, an extended one, but no. Chibnall had to cram everything into one episode. The concept is bad, the execution is worse, and the fact it's squeezed with these other episodes is a mess. An absolute sham. I can understand why this is a hated episode. Even some people's least favourites of the show, or at least the modern series. I disagree on that part, because Hellbent's even worse, because it betrays the Doctor as a character. But this is still really low. Again, if the concept had been handled better, might not have been so bad. Not a great idea, but it could have been better. But we got this. And whilst many people are more upset about the concept, I'm in the camp that say, but the whole episode, what we got, how it was delivered, and how messy it and other parts of the story were, that's what made this episode bad. Not the concept, the execution. And unfortunately, that's probably why The Timeless Children has gone down as the most controversial episode since the TV movie hit. And people like the TV movie now. I like the TV movie. We don't mind the changes made in that, for the most part. So, maybe, who knows, maybe this story might get a reprisal later down the line or something. But as of right now, it's considered the worst episode ever made. That isn't The Twin Dilemma or Love and Monsters. So, yeah. And that's why Series 12 is the most controversial series ever, because of this one episode, and maybe some other bits from others, but mostly this. Well, we're done. What do you mean I still got Revolution of the Daleks? Oh, fuck, yes, I do. Oh, yeah, and Revolution of the Daleks. Oh, yeah, end of Timeless Children, the Doctor is just randomly arrested by the Jadoon in the TARDIS and then sent to this prison, meaning that Yaz, Ryan and Graham have to deal with this Dalek threat and Jack Robertson, who's much better here than he was in Arachnids in the UK, without her. But Captain Jack, who previously appeared in Fugitive of the Jadoon after setting up series finale and special baiting, comes in, breaks her out, and they return to Earth. And you know, the whole stuff about how do you save the world without the Doctor stuff? Well, basically, you just go and confront Jack Robertson, say it's hard, look at some pictures, and then the Doctor just turns up, and it's business as usual, with the inclusion of Captain Jack, and later also Jack Robertson reluctantly goes with them as well. So apparently Jack Robertson is using Dalek casings inspired by the one from Resolution to make his own security drone things. And then his assistant Leo takes DNA of the original mutant, clones it. Robertson sees it, smartly says get rid of it, although it's more out of disgust rather than smartness. But then Leo, before he kills it, he is taken over by the reconnaissance Dalek clone and then sets about cloning more reconnaissance Dalek clones and sending them off to go into the security drone cases. And so these new Daleks take over. The Doctor then has to resort to calling the SAS Daleks to then come and deal with the impure Daleks. So we get a mini Dalek civil war in the story. It doesn't very last very long, but it happens. And we go back to those civil wars of the 80s. For a bit, and eventually they then have to get the Daleks to go away again, the other Daleks, basically that's what happens. Yeah, that pretty much sums up this episode. Oh, and Ryan Graham at leave at the end. Ryan, because he wants to stay on Earth and hang out with his friends and stuff, because he misses a lot of time from Earth when traveling, and Graham decides to stay with him because family. But Yaz is now obsessed with the Doctor, which we've been seeing happen a little bit throughout series 12, especially at the end and in this episode, and we're going to see it up to 11 in series 13, and especially the two specials afterwards, possibly also the third one as well. So, yeah, so she's staying, and we'll see more of her next series, which is good because she needs some more most development. And, yeah, it's actually a pretty decent exit, all things considered. I'm actually glad they weren't killed off or given a nasty situation to go out on with a contrived way out, like Moffat did. Although I did like Bill getting a happy ending, so I guess I'm a bit contradictory in some places. But Clara should have died. Clara should have died. But yeah, Ryan Graham getting a nice exit here. Yeah, nice. I have also heard the theory that Graham might be getting killed off in the Centenary special. So at time recording, I can neither confirm or deny this. And this video will hopefully go out before the Centenary special airs. So we'll have to talk about that when we talk about that episode. As for here, it's a decent exit. Could be better, but it could be worse as well. So, yeah. So this episode is pretty good, pretty fun, pretty enjoyable. And yeah, it's alright. Pretty fun New Year special. And after the garbage series finale, it's a step in back in the right direction in terms of decent storytelling, at the very least. And it's 70 minutes, so at least with all the stuff it has to do, it does most of it pretty well in a pretty consistent time. Unlike a future special that's coming up later down the line, but more on that next video. So, that's Series 12 and Revolution of the Daleks, for real this time. I used to think this series was better than Series 11. I used to like it a bit more when it was broadcasting. However, looking back on it and re-reviewing both series last year, and reflecting on it, revisiting, rewatching, etc., etc., Series 11 not only did it feel better watching it, and now I'd gotten used to the era, but also it was the better series. It was better structured, better episodes, better design. This one was just a mess all over the place. There's a couple of good episodes in there, as I mentioned, but there's also quite a few bad ones, more so than Series 11. So I think the story arc doesn't work that well overall either. At least it's got a story arc as opposed to the last series, but doesn't work that well, especially as some episodes basically avoid it, like the Orphan 55, Nikola Tesla, Praxis, and to a smaller extent, Can You Hear Me, where it is mentioned once or twice. But, yeah, I suppose Haunting of Villa Diodati, but that does tie into the next two, so that's why I didn't mention that until just now. But, yeah, so that's why I think Series 12 is now the weakest of the three series, because it's kind of a bit of a mess overall, not just that last episode, but it's a bit of a mess. It could have been handled so much better, but ultimately now I'm used to the feel, and I can go back and look at Series 11 in a fresh light and enjoy more of it, including some episodes I wasn't so keen on the first time around, like It Takes You Away, as well as maybe some reevaluate some other episodes, and the same here. Then, yeah, Series 12 ends up being my least favourite of the Jodie Whittaker era, not to anybody's surprise, I suppose. Though I am not sure if I would say Series 11 is my favourite just yet. I'm going to have to talk about Series 13 before I make that final decision. There was some good stuff in here. Haunting of Hill Diodati and Nikola Tesla's Light of Terror. Enjoyed Spyfall, enjoyed Revolution of the Daleks. But there were also some big duds, like Orphan 55 and Ascension of Simon and the Timeless Children. Very mixed bag. It should have been better. Not could, should have been better. Especially that finale. If they're going to do what they're going to do, at least make it executed better. And cut the Brendan shit out the episode before and sort your Scythman stuff out there, if even at all. You might even needed the Scythman stuff. You know that the term having your cake and eating it? Well, this one, it's you eat too much. You eat too much cake and you can tell it's not gone well. For episodes I recommend for beginners, I definitely say Spyfall Parts 1 and 2 and Nikola Tesla's Night of Terror and maybe Praxis as well. Those are best for beginners. And or continuing from Series 11 without having to deal with the main story arc. For those who want the main story arc, the first two episodes, again, Fugitive of the Jadoon, and the last three episodes. And also Revolution of the Daleks. And anybody else, just pick and choose. But if you are a beginner and or just following on from selected episodes from Series 11 and or of just wanting the story arc, avoid Orphan 55. The other episodes work better in one or more of those camps, but Orphan 55 is just one you can watch if watching the whole series. So that's Series 12, Season 38. It wasn't great. But I don't know if I'd say it's the worst series ever. I certainly prefer more of these stories than in this series to some in other series, which would bump up this season's pros, in my opinion. It's mainly the structure of the story arc doesn't quite work. Orphan 55, Nikola Tesla, and Praxis completely avoid it. And Can You Hear Me only mentions it like once or twice. Yeah, and there's not even that much character stuff in those other three stories. Can You Hear Me basically does the legwork for most of the series on that front, to be honest. So, yeah, so I can't even say it's that great on those levels either. Still, we've got story arc, so those who didn't like Series 11 for not having a story arc, like Samuel something, not Samuel Davis, someone else, the guy who did the YouTuber awards thing. He didn't like Series 11 because it didn't have a story arc, which is just one factor of a series. But you know, if I hope you like Series 12 more then, mate, because this one's got an arc. Not a very good one, but it's got one. Samuel Lewis, that was it. But yeah, this one's got an arc. It's not a good arc, but yeah, not all the episodes are great, but not all of them are bad either. So like Series 11, bit of a mixed bag. I would say 11's still better, though, from the structure, from some of the stories, and just being a more good time. Also, many of these episodes are stuffed to bursting point in this series, while Series 11 has a bit more freedom, let's say. It's like they were made by different showrunners. Anyway, so that's Series 12 over, thank goodness. Sorry for the length of this video being very long. There was a lot to cover, especially with that finale. I had to skim through as much as I could, and I spent too long on the first two. Sorry about that. Anyway, next up is Series 13, aka Flux, the latest series, and the 2022 specials, at least the first two. I don't own them yet. Series 13. So, yeah, I'll see you guys next time for part three of this video, which will be dealing with Series 13 and the first two of the 2022 specials. As I mentioned, the Centenary will be getting its own video later down the line after it's aired, as these first couple will be coming up beforehand. So until then, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye. To subscribe to the Nicholas Payne YouTube channel. Because part zero was the intro. And the 2019 New Year special, Revolution. Fuck. And the 2019 New Year special, Fuck. Stay still. I'll cut that. So, what makes Series 12? And to be fair, once you've got the map, and once you've played, and honestly, it's one of, and ultimately, they discover that his Spymaster is in fact the same master, Yeah, I mean, maybe O could have been, maybe there could have been a bit. And he is brilliant, mixing that brilliant this. And at the end, we also see a bit of sadness with his character, with what he's had to do. Is my focus on? Okay. If my focus was going a bit funny, sorry about that. But yeah. Anyway. And the third series got cut in short. This seemed like to be honest, this is a move. This is, and after Hellbent, I know I would bring it back and I'd just leave it. I know I would do it if I was showrunner. Yeah, I know, I'm going to go there. I know I would do if I was showrunner. Now, say the same time, supporting cast is like 2 to 5 characters. Not too much, but we got 11 in this one. Well, I suppose actually, including the Doctor and company, it's 11 or 12 characters. No. Maybe get out alive because we've got at least three supporting characters who are going to... Because of shit like this. I'm not against climate change. I'm for climate change. No, I'm not. That's a... I'm saying it was handled badly. But this message was... At least the direction looks nice. It looks... Where any one or all three could easily have been... whilst the most of the scenes are stolen by Edison... But holy shit, is this episode gonna completely gonna... Who is this fugitive? Or is it a quarter? Especially Big Finish. But at the same time, this is all we've gotten with stuff. Oh, I should say Pete Mattie and Chris Chib. I think the my faith, yeah. Certain checker. Like the Eternals from the Key to Time saga and the Black Guardian trilogy, and also this the Eternals also from the Black Guardian trilogy. But yeah, the story feels like it. So she went back to sort it, go and visit her afterward. Even though he, as when the Doctor and friend, some of her friend, but you know, it could be worse, but it could be. Okay, so again, a bit of a mixed bag. But I think the highs weren't as high this series and the lows were even lower than series 11. I think at the time I did think the series was it definitely went back down in opinion. Something's gone wrong with the fucking thing. But after revisiting it, it did go back down in opinion, and I just think series 11 is just the better series of the two now, and I'm leaning towards that's the stronger of the three overall. At least for storytelling reasons, anyway. Even if not all of them were great. But, yeah, but I would avoid watching Orphan 55 if you are either a begin, if you are not a big. I'd certainly prefer a lot. I certainly prefer it over. So, Future Me, this is an extra bit to go at the end of the first block of this video's footage and the start of the next. It's just kind of in the middle to bridge that gap due to the video cutting off prematurely. Okay, back to what else I'm saying.